Hello everyone, today I'm going to talk about the histopathology slides. The learning objectives of this class are, I would like to tell you about the normal histology of the skin because I'm dealing with squamous papilloma, the benign one, and also the squamous cell carcinoma, the malignant one. And then the normal histology of the appendix, clinical presentation and complications of acute appendicitis, histopathology of acute appendicitis. So the normal skin consists of epidermis, dermis, and the epidermal junction is the one which separates the epidermis and the dermis. What this epidermis consists of is the keratinized squamous epithelium that is usually stratified, and then the dermis is composed of the fibrous elastic connective tissue layer. So this dermis is attached beneath it to the adipose tissue, and then in the epidermis and the dermis, the dermoepidermal junction can be in the form of ridges, which are called as the epidermal ridges or the reti ridges, interdigitate with the upward projections of the dermis called the dermal papillae. What is the dermal papillae? See, the dermis consists of the papillary dermis and also the reticular dermis. This papillary dermis is the one which is supplying the epidermis. Okay, it has loose connective tissue, whereas the reticular dermis is the one which is more dense and it is responsible for the strength and elasticity. So here we are seeing, this is the stratified squamous epithelium and this is the dermoepidermal junction. This is the dermis. Okay. So what layers we have in the epidermis again? We have the stratum basale. See, the stratum basale is like the brick generator. That means that it will generate, it has some stem cells. It has some undifferentiated keratinocytes which can actually help the cells to proliferate. So that's the reason why you know that in winter your skin gets dry. That means the dead skin falls off and then the new skin cells will be regenerated. So this regeneration happens at the stratum basale level. Okay, so that means that the stratum basale is helping us in two ways. One is proliferation and the other one is attachment. Okay, then the other layer comes, that is the stratum spinosum. Spinous cells, spine-like cells will be there. See, why there are the spinous-like cells is because there is, in the cells, we have this microfilaments, you know, and then intercellular desmosomes, right? So these microfilaments and these desmosomes are shrunken. So that's the reason why in this layer, we find the spinous-like cells. So what is the function of this stratum spinosum? It gives strength and flexibility. Okay, so the stratum basale is proliferation and attachment. The stratum spinosum is the strength and flexibility. And we have known that we have this undifferentiated keratinocytes and then the stem cells here for the regeneration acting as a brick generator. Then stratum spinosum, other name is called as prickle cell layer because the cells are spiny. Then we're talking about the stratum granulosum, the third layer. See, this is the thin layer. It has the keratohyalin granules. Okay. This keratohyalin granules actually form a very thin layer. And the function and the purpose of it is that it prevents the water fluid loss from the body to the outside. So this is about the stratum granulosum. Okay, you have to remember keratohyalin granules. The function is to prevent the fluid loss. And then stratum corneum, you know that when the skin, the tensile strength of the skin is being, we are able to resist heat some amount and we are able to resist some tissue, and the tensile strength and all of that friction is being handled because of the stratum corneum, which is made up of the keratin. So these are the four epidermal layers you have to know. I've already told about the dermal layers. I just repeated the papillary dermis and the reticular dermis. The papillary dermis is loose. This supplies the epidermis. because it consists of the capillaries which are supplied. So the nutrition is being supplied by the papillary dermis. The reticulodermis is a dense layer which is consisting, which is actually made of the collagen fibers, and then it is helping in the strength. So here we are seeing the four layers, the stratum corneum, the stratum granulosum, okay, the stratum spinosum. I told you the microfilaments and the desmosomes are a little bit shrunken. The stratum vessel having the undifferentiated keratinocytes, and this is the brick generator, right? See, I'm just using the term brick generator so that you will understand. That means it consists of stem cells. This is the dermis, so this is the dermoepidermal junction, okay? So there are some specialized cells of the epidermis known as the non-keratinocytes. The function of the squamous cell is to produce the keratin. But there are something which is also present and is not producing this keratin. They are the melanocytes which are having the pigment, which is infusing, they are imparting the color to the skin. The Langerhans cells, see, this Langerhans cells are the specialized cells or the macrophages which are present in the skin. The Merkel cells, see, the Merkel cells are the specialized epithelial cells for the tactile sensation, like the light touch sensation. When, see, somebody comes from outside and then they touch you, you know that this person is this. That is given by the Merkel cell, that fine touch. So this is the melanocyte, the pigment, macrophages of the skin, the Langerhans, Merkel cells, the specialized epithelial cells which are having this, so that they are giving some help with the sensation. So the epidermal appendages, the skin can have hair, right? So the hair follicles are present, the sebaceous glands are present, sweat glands, secretin and apocrine glands are present. So after thorough understanding of the squamous epithelium, that is stratified squamous epithelium with the four epidermal layers, and sometimes we have another layer called stratum lucidum, which is present in the palms and soles. It is thin, clear layer, which is having the dead cells. Okay, just remember that there is another layer of the skin called as stratum lucidum, which is having dead skin cells present in the soles and palm. Okay, that is different from all the other things in the skin. Okay, now coming to the benign proliferation of the squamous epithelium into finger-like projections, that will form something called as squamous papilloma. So what are we saying? Finger-like projections. Then epithelium shows hyperplasia, that is the number of cells are increased, hyperkeratosis, increase in keratin, core of the papilla made up of fibrovascular, and the dermis is normal. So here we see, this is the normal squamous epithelium we are seeing here, which has suddenly overgrown, that is hyperplasia, into finger-like projections like this. And then you see there is a core into the finger-like projections, that is the fibrovascular core that is essential for the proliferation of the cells. So this is the LOPA picture showing the squamous papilloma. Then here we have the HIPAA picture, that is the squamous papilloma. Again, this is the core. If you take this one as a papillary structure, and this is a squamous epithelium lining, and you have this core having the fibrous tissue and also the vessels supplying it. So this is the histopathology of the squamous papilloma. So what you see in squamous papilloma, the finger-like projections above the surface of the skin, okay? And then what you see is a fibrovascular core, and then this papillary projection lined by the stratified squamous epithelium, which is benign. Okay, that is important. What is benign, what is malignant? You have to know the differences. Uniform looking cells. There is no abnormality in the cells. There is no nuclear enlargement or anything like that. We just see hyperplasia, and then we can sometimes see hypertrophy. That's all with the benign. Then what you see in the malignant cells, now we'll come to know that. The squamous cell carcinoma, see, I told you that the skin contains of stratified squamous epithelium. Then you have the epidermis, the layers of the epidermis, the papillary dermis, the reticular dermis underlying the fat tissue, right? So what happens in squamous cell carcinoma is that there can be an abnormal mutation that is leading to the proliferation of these undifferentiated cells or poorly differentiated cells, or with the tumor recapitulating the function, that is the production of the keratin. So whatever it is, the cells are not uniform, the nucleus cytoplasmic ratio is not maintained, there is large cell which are irregular, the stratification, that means you are seeing the stratum basale, then you are seeing the spinosum, granulosum, and the corneum. All these are maintained like bricks, right? So that is being lost. So there is some irregularity in the proliferation. One is normal, another is abnormal. So there is some irregularity in the proliferation at first. So there is a mutation, and the mutation is leading to irregular proliferation. And the number of cells produced are being different. And then the cellular arrangement gets different. And then there is abnormal nuclear enlargement. Because of the increased proliferation, you know that the malignant cells turnover is very fast. So the proliferation is at a rapid rate compared to the benign counterpart. So it is having more proliferation. So that is being marked by the mitosis, nuclear, abnormal nuclear enlargement, increased NC ratio, that is nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, you have irregular nuclear borders. And the typical of the squamous cell carcinoma is it can recapture the function of the keratin production, and there can be some keratin pearl formation. So what you have to see to call it as squamous cell carcinoma is this layer, which has to be on the top, that means there should be a proper dermo-epidermal junction. So this junction is disrupted by the proliferating, bulging burden of the epidermal cells, which are carcinomatous, and then they just go into the dermis. So what happens because of the increasing derm burden? There is a downward proliferation of the epidermal cells into the dermis. This is known as invasion. That means there is a border. You cross the border. That means there is something invading, right? So the individual cells show pleomorphism. That's the term when you talk about malignancy. You have to use this term, pleomorphism. Nuclear hyperchromasia, that means darkening. Then presence of intercellular bridges and abnormal mitotic figures, malignant squamous cells with keratin pearls. So this is the keratin pearl, what you're seeing here. And these are not uniform, right? All these cells, they are not looking uniform. And then you are seeing a lot of pleomorphism and hyperchromasia. These cells can be typical of that. And then you can see that there is irregular nuclear borders. Okay, so see, these are the pleomorphic cells. You can see the prominent nucleoli here. This is the nucleus which is enlarged, and then you can see that the cytoplasm to the nuclear ratio is getting damaged. And then here we see the abnormal mitosis. You know the phases of mitosis, right? That is not maintained because of the rapid proliferation. So this is another slide showing, see, some cells are small, some cells are big, so there is no uniformity. See, if you think of a benign tumor, think of some school children wearing a uniform on normal days, and then, you know, coming to the school. Then at the prayer, how they look? They look so uniform, right? But if there is a Saturday or Friday, they are having some color coding. I mean, like, you can wear any other thing like uniform. Then they will try to dress up in their own way. One person may wear some pant, jeans or whatever. One person may wear something else. Like, you know, there may not be a uniformity in what they wear. And the color also will not be the same. Okay, so that is representation of a malignancy wherein there is no uniformity, pleomorphism. Okay, and then see, this is the mitotic figures what you are seeing. This mitotic figure. So even in squamous cell carcinoma, any carcinoma per se, if the cell is trying to recapitulate its functions, if a skin its keratin production, so then it is called as well differentiated squamous cell carcinoma with a keratin pearl formation. If that is not maintained, and sometimes there is just this cell producing some amount of keratin which may not form a pearl, but you can find that outside the cell, that is called the individual cell keratinization or dyskeratosis, then it is known as the moderately differentiated squamous cell carcinoma. If we are unable to say that this particular tumor belongs to the skin or the squamous cell, then you should term that as a poorly differentiated carcinoma, right? So this is about the squamous cell carcinoma. Now we'll talk about the histology of normal appendix. The structure of the appendix is having what layers histologically? Mucus, submucus, muscular, and serous. So the appendix also consists of the lymphoid tissue in the lamina propria that usually bulges into the appendix lumen. Okay, so this is important about the lymphoid tissue. Okay, so what is a mucosa? The first layer of the appendix contain the columnar epithelium, and also there are some endocrine cells for the argentiferous cells, and the same cells of the colon, that is the Koblenz cells. The appendix is common site of carcinoid also, which are the endocrine tumors arising from that, right? So see here, this is the mucosa, which is lined by the columnar cell epithelium, right? The lamina propria having the aggregates of the lymphoid follicles here. And then you can see that this is the submucosa, and then the muscular layer and the serosa. Okay, so how is the muscular layer? This is a circular muscle layer, and this is the longitudinal muscle layer. Okay, so again, the histology of appendix, the lumen, you know that it is like a finger-shaped structure, right? So there is a lumen. When we cut it transversely, this is transverse section. So this one, you see, this is the mucosa having the columnar epithelium, the lamina propria with lymphoid aggregates here. And then we see the submucosa. And then I did not label here, but this is a muscle layer, circular and longitudinal, and then the serosa, and this is the mesoappendix. Okay, so what is acute appendicitis? Appendicitis, inflammation of the appendix. Okay, so it is, what is a stereotypic presentation? There is some pain in the periumbilical pain, which is called as a McBurney's point. Where it is located? It is located 3.8 to 5.7 centimeters, so the right anterior iliac spine, in line with the umbilicus. So once somebody comes and says, see, when you draw a line over the right anterior iliac spine to the umbilicus, from that 3.8 to 5 centimeters midway, you have the McBurney's point. If the pain is radiating there, you have to suspect an acute appendicitis. If the patient is also presenting with all these symptoms like fever, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, GERD, and rebound tenderness. Okay. And here we have some signs you have to remember regarding the acute appendicitis. That is the Rossing sign. Okay. That means upon palpation of the left lower quadrant, we have this guarding and rebound tenderness. Okay. That is the Rossing sign. And pain with the once you ask the patient to extend the right hip and then he is having a lot of pain, then it is Swart sign. And then you try to ask them to do an internal rotation of the hip, that is having pain, then it is obturator sign. So Rossing sign, Swart sign, and obturator sign. So what are the complications of acute appendicitis? It can lead to perforation if untreated. and then there can be peritonitis after the perforation, that is the inflammatory cells which are sticking to the appendix may now get lodged into the peritoneal cavity. Then abscess, pyelophlebitis, and sometimes death in neglected cases because it may lead to septicemia and shock. Fibrous luminal obliteration may be sequelae of the acute appendicitis. So now coming to the histopath aspects. See, once a surgeon knows that there is this, all signs are elicited, there is tenderness in the membranous point, and he tries to examine and elicits all the signs, there is fever, he will subject the patient to the OT. Right, after the operation, the appendix is sent to the pathology department. What is the reason for this? So once we see the appendix, we'll cut into the longitudinal and horizontal planes. Then we put it onto the slide and see if there is any other lesion contributing to the appendicitis, or it is just inflammation, or there is any underlying pathology like carcinoma, or we missing any kind of endocrine tumor, or is it just an acute appendicitis without any perforation, or will it go to any septicemia or peritonitis or something like that. So in the histopathology, hallmark of two call it as acute appendicitis. See, once we cut, we see the mucosa, the lamina propria with the lymphoid tissue, right, muscularis, and then this submucosa and the muscle layer, that circular, longitudinal, and the serosa, right? So this thing, if it is to call it something abnormal, we have to find some very hallmarks, right? Sometimes in the gloss itself, the pus may be oozing up. Okay, in the microscopy, what we see is this acute mucosal inflammation, neutrophilic infiltrates within the lumen, and depending on the severity, there can be the mucosal sloughing. That means the mucosa is not present uniformly. It can just get sloughed. That means it's kind of ulcerated, right? So the hallmark to call the appendix to be acute appendicitis, we have to see the inflammation consisting of neutrophils in the muscular layer in the appendixial wall. If we are not seeing these neutrophils in the appendix muscular wall, that means this can be appendicitis, but it may be chronic but not acute. So for calling it as acute, we have to see the neutrophils in the muscle layer of the appendiceal wall. So here we are seeing the histopath picture. This is the lumen. You can see that the inflammatory infiltrate, okay, there is sloughed off mucosal layer here, and then here we are seeing the lamina propria studded with inflammation, and sometimes you can see the inflammation spreading to until the serosa. All of this, this may be called as a transmural inflammation, and then the serosa also may get make the muscle may get torn. That may be a sign of perforation. So we have to examine like that layer by layer, so that what stage of acute appendicitis it is. Stage means what level, complication level. Okay, acute focal. The term itself says that it is just limited. Acute suppurative, more important. Okay, gangrenous. You know the term gangrene, right? So it is almost like it has gone wound up. Perforative, there is a muscle perforation that you are able to demonstrate even at the histopathology. So this granulation tissue response can be apparent in some cases. That means, see, sometimes whenever there is an acute inflammation, it is definitely trying to heal. The body tries to heal with the inflammatory factors and then the granulation tissue, right? So this may be very, very apparent in some cases. And in some minority of cases, you can see foamy histiocytes with lymphohistiocytic response. And this is the xanthogranulomatous appendicitis. So the terminology is important. The acute appendicitis, we are finding the neutrophils, right? Then if the granulation tissue is more, we can see like it is called cissatrial fibrosis in the appendix, and if we are terming it as xanthogranulomatous, we are finding the lymphohistiocytic type containing the foam histiocytes in the inflammatory response in the appendicitis. So we have also seen there are some types like focal, suppurative, gangrenous, and perforative appendicitis. So that is all about the three slides what you have to learn today. That is the squamous papilloma, squamous cell carcinoma, and also the appendix. I don't think I got any response from any of you regarding the assignment I've given regarding the urine microscopy. If you have listened to the class of the urine microscopy, I've asked you to make some table and give it to me. I will wait for another day for your response. So please respond. Otherwise, I need to tell your HOD regarding your sincerity towards the class, right? So that is all about it. Thank you.